you have the working group 5, which is related to the development of guidelines, and it is important, as stated also in the website of the project, to facilitate the implementation of the principles and methods developed in the other working groups. So it should be an attractive part to be used by committees, for example, the FIB, Committee on Structural Monitoring, the Eurocodes, ISO, and so on. So it should be a pre-normative documents. They will be discussed with the Joint Committee on Structural Safety in the future, as it was stated this morning. So we have Working Group 5, and I will present here briefly, according to the contents, which are again given, so the contents. First, we have an introduction. So we will plan, or we are planning to issue 2 documents before the finalization of the code. One document is the methods and background document to be used within the Joint Committee on Structural Safety, so it will be part of the so-called probabilistic model. Probabilistic model code is a code which is giving guidelines on what kind of methods or models should be used to cover uncertainties in structural design and verification of existing structures. So it's not working as the Euro code based on fixed parameters, but it uses a probabilistic, let's say, philosophy to verify the structure and to see if certain targets on reliability are met according to the consequences of failure and to cost of investing in safety. This is the first document, and this is prepared by Sebastian, as far as I understand, with some help by others. We are a little bit behind in this document, but we have time until April to make, let's say, to make it. The second document is the one mainly my colleague and myself are working, Miroslav Sikora from Prague, and myself. And this is aiming to give guideline, summarize things, and give guideline for practicing engineers. And practicing engineers are engineers who have studied engineering and they work in practice. Typically are young engineers, or even old engineers who have studied 5-6 years, and they are working at the consulting companies or construction companies, and they should somehow understand something out of it. Because it is, if I'm preparing such a document, I'm thinking of my students, we have finished, and I am responsible of meeting all the students, and I am also thinking how can we make it attractive that people are able to understand. This is very important. So, we have 2 documents. The second one is, a draft is existing. We have discussed it in Amsterdam twice. We have discussed it in Lisbon last April. We have been receiving comments and we have implemented them. And one should be, of course, think that these documents are pre-normative documents, so they should help other standardization bodies. For example, as I said before, FIB, which presented a very new model code, the project teams in the Eurocodes, ISO committees, and so on. So the aims is to implement results of the other working groups, such as methodologies, tools, and strategies. And the second important thing for me is to, let's say, structure the results of the case studies, because there are different case studies. If you go ahead from going through all case studies, you start with them again and again, we have to structure it. We have to structure it from the theoretical point of view, but also from the structural point. Is it a building? Is it a bridge? Is it a heritage structure, for example, which is also existing? And what is the problem? And also from the methodology to structure. Can I use posterior Bayesian analysis or not? This is not always given. Estimation of cost. Also a problem. So we have developed a document, and then we have developed also a case study on monitoring of snow load on the roof of a stadium. We selected the purpose of this case study because it's easy to be, at least according to me, it's easy to be understood by engineers. You measure the snow load, you can say something about the reliability, you can say something about the consequences of failure of the roof, and you can say something about the risk of using the structure, and you can either eliminate the snow or you can close the stadium and so on. So there is a case study which is typical for this, let's say, development of the guidelines. We plan, we have presented that already in the upset, the guidelines and the application. We have submitted a paper for ICAS conference in Seoul, and we have included in a special issue of the structural engineering journal, which was issued last August. So there are dissemination activities, achievements. The first one, we consider structural health monitoring in a very broad term. We consider not only the classical monitoring, but also spot monitoring, like, let's say, proof loading or taking measurements, single measurements, or many measurements out of the structure, destructive and non-destructive tests. We have a work on combination of destructive and non-destructive tests of masonry. We represent again the description in the practical terms of the design process, what are the parameters which are important in the design process, what are the procedures. We define various performance indicators. So a performance indicator can be, for example, a limit value for a snow load, but can be also the reliability of the roof, but can be also the risk of using the structure. What is an acceptable risk? So we can go up to one value to a more refined, let's say, risk-informed parameter. There are now decision criteria, and also the verification of the value of information without with monitoring. One can do it in advance with posterior Bayesian analysis. You can evaluate this and see if it is worth of using the monitoring system. We are integrating this into state of practice, also by using example in an annex. It is a typical free standard, and we have experience in writing, let's say, working with code committees, many people in the group, so it is compatible with the way of writing in other committees, and we've got also support by colleagues and so on. Dissemination. It's in the website. We have the two drafts of the guidelines. The one for theoretical background, probabilistic model code, the other one for practicing engineers. We have publications, as I mentioned before. We have presented them in meetings, for example, in the after meetings we had, and also in the FIB meeting, the last one in Munich. We have presented and discussed that earlier in your very well-organized innovation days in Lisbon, and we had some reaction, especially from your friend Carlos, who wrote me again an email, and he was very much looking to the practical implementation of these things, because he wants to see where to place the money. And social media, we have in LinkedIn and in SearchGrid, and also what is important, seminars and universities. For example, I mentioned this project that I presented in one of the slides. I was giving lectures in Armenia and Georgia last week. So we always think to include at least when we do presentations in other universities. And also it's important to educate young people. They are all very well in technologies, the young students, and if they have also the theory behind this structural health monitoring, it's easier for them to implement in the future tools and guidelines. So implementation in course materials, for example, master degree courses on structural health monitoring, use of additional information. The concept to finalize this, we have to finalize, so one has to be very, very fast, because we finish in the beginning of next year. We're a little bit behind with the first document, but I think we have now to finish, so we don't have time to do more experiments. Now we have to finish and have it at a level which is acceptable. So, we have still some time, however, for discussion with our working group members. We might need an additional meeting before the final conference. We are presenting it constantly. We are discussing it with practical engineers and in cases where for example, I am involved, I'm discussing with colleagues and so on, so I always, as a practicing engineer, I myself a practicing engineer, so I'm designing buildings and also verifying existing buildings, so I have one eye and the other eye as a scientist in research results. And what is important is to have, as I said, always internal evaluation here, but also there will be probably an external evaluation of the project, so one has to see both aspects, internal and external. Because there's a tendency internally to say things are very well, but you need also an eye from outside. Now the lessons learned, what did we learn out of this doing that? Of course, we had some problems to coordinate, and there are so different options to finalize two documents, a comprehensive one summarizing activities and being also in a code format. The problem myself is that if you do risk analysis, you always have uncertain parameters which are related to the cost of failure. There are a big discrepancy when you talk to practicing engineers and you tell them assess the cost of failure here, if this wall will fail, they will come up with different, let's say, results. It's not a stress analysis, so one should be very careful doing these things. Sometimes it's necessary to do some ranking or to categorize consequences in consequence classes, as the codes are doing. One needs simplifications. It should be applicable for practice engineer, proportionality. If you have a very big important bridge, you like it was mentioned, the bridge in Genoa, which I was taking many times while I was living there between 87 and 92. One, if he has a very important structure, he has to do more things compared to a smaller one, a not so important one. Then the interaction with the industry is very important, and I realized that in Lisbon, because this is important, how can I convince people? Because if we convince professor among them, this is very easy. One says one method, the other one is very nice. But if you go to a company and they have to invest money, they will ask you. But it's different thing if you sign that one building or one bridge is funny, and a different thing if you put your signature on a paper. You know that also. Huh? If I
submit a paper they ask for the original signature, I sign and I send. If they like, they accept. If it is a conference, because I pay the keys. If you design the building or if you do verification of existing building, you have to be perfect. The building has to stay so it's. You should realize that practicing engineer is practicing engineer. Yeah, this is the word. So, we have the methods here. We try to combine, of course, the interesting research results with the methods, with the decision trees, so on, to deal with uncertainty. It's very important. I agree on that. Uncertainty is very important to be there. We need guidance on that. So, this is, for me, the important lesson, the combination of these two things. But this is not now, I knew that also before. So, preparation of two background documents with terminology and compatible flowcharts is the outcome. Criteria for the development and interaction with other working groups. Now, we will hear the case studies, so we have to listen to all case studies to see what is important for this, if we include this, how can we put it inside? We discuss and present the various applications, costs or benefits of the structural health monitoring, the quantification of information is a very important aspect, and the presentation of practical to practical engineers and feedback, as we had in Lisbon, and as also we will have in the future. As I understand from there. So, outreach is something which is not easy to understand, but means outreach. Outreach, everybody has a different opinion. So, outreach for me is you use the results in consultancy services. You go to RISA and you help them to do a monitoring program based on the decision criteria. You use this result of the project in your code committee work. You are a member of the code committee of FID, you are a member of the Bureau Codes, project teams, and you try to think behind what can we do here, how can I use additional information, how can I leave space in the Bureau Code to use additional information, to invest money, and to have, let's say, another type of verification of the structure. And the most important is to educate young people. Young people are educated, master leadership, structural health monitoring, validation of additional information, uncertainty, modeling, and so on. This is a good step because in the future, these young people will go out and will probably be, let's say, in the situation to at least some of them apply some of the tools. So this is the, let's say, the presentation behind the final fact sheet. I think it was very general. What we have presented in Lisbon, the guidelines we have presented already in Lisbon. So this is the final stage, we are at the final stage. And well, maybe we should discuss here. You would like to present Sebastian first, we have a general discussion. I don't know what you think. You can decide. Yeah. So the first few questions with respect to my presentation or what is behind.
Not a question, but comment, because Marius in this presentation talked about consultants that they are trying to prepare another document. I think leading uncertainties, leading uncertainties, this is directly related to what we are trying to practice these guidelines. So do you collaborate with them?
I have not collaborated with others, but I have studied the results of working group 3, and we have included how uncertainties, that uncertainties have to be dealt with. In which place and how. I think this is a good comment. We should refer to that document. If they prepare a specific document based on their experience, what kind of uncertainties, for example, model or specific measurement uncertainties and so on. I would also include, we have included the cost estimation. we should have cross-reference, and at certain points I would like to add, to take your comment and try to manage and include it. I think this is an important thing if we send in also our drafts and we get this draft to include. I think this is a good idea. It is one additional step to be taken, I agree with you. So I'm going to take this step.
Which not me, everybody is involved, and
started. The problem is we started with other persons. We had some schedule and it was not respected by some people who were occupied probably, so trying to recommend who would like to I sent the prison draft, I want to collect small things, to send, of course, to you and to a group of five, not come to 50 people, but a group of 5 to 10 people, to get some specific comments, because if you write and can you write again, I will not do it because I don't have time, because sometimes you may receive some general comments I will include it. But these comments were very specific, which we have today. So I would like to send to a group of people who are involved to get within the deadline some comments, more specific. And I mean, you should imagine that we cannot work on that. We don't have a position. So, and then we will see the necessity maybe of a small meeting with these people who commented or who are interested to participate and finalize. It can be a Skype meeting, it can be a physical meeting. I think this could be a help for us. We have got comments up to now from some people, including Tom Brandenberger, who is very experienced in writing, so he wrote me personally some aspects to change and so on and so on. So this is the first, this is the only thing that we have to finish by the final conference. So I don't want to do experiments now. That's the edge we have to deliver.
Maybe it could be useful if you want to more, because maybe we have the list of people that were interested at the beginning of the action. Maybe now there are other people that are interested. So it could be useful to send a call for contributors and ask people who else could be interested to work on this guidance, for example. We would get more people.
Of course, in such a case, maybe you say yes. If you see the joint committee, or if you see the names that are going out, there are 100. And suddenly there are only, so I personally, I know who. I mean, you can say, yeah, I've sent to some of you also, so if you know what I mean, everybody will say yes. And then, I don't want comments from other people. I want from the maximum. I can ask, yes, this is just do an experiment. Who is interested? I will send you. I have sent you, but I can. No?
That's why I'm saying.
I didn't first. The first thing is working that we don't want to include people who don't want to be included.
No, that's why I'm saying send a call for contributors.
Okay, we send a call for contributors to all participants, this 100 persons. You have a list, should we? What do you think? You are the
can you think of the direction of standardization organizations like FIB, where we already have some things, but there are more.
Anybody here who would like to comment? Yes. Okay. we have already from FIP and Delta, we have two potential and two youth also. Yeah. Okay.
Just as a point to here, we also have somehow from all the first liberal from 5 the technical recognition.
Some not. So it's interesting to include. state of the case study, so it would be, I think, very beneficial to do that. But do you have a, maybe you can say more about that?
Maybe just to support the your work, you can ask the responsible of the case studies to check where they can study the fit in your document.
Yeah, but what is the final practice of the case studies? You have the fact sheets. You have the final list of fact sheets.
There is a format
on the website. Yeah, the format. I should not have used it wrong. Okay. What I can find is.
So. Yes, actually, send you this green draft of this German guideline for offshoring. It's a good example. It has also some other fact sheet in the end, but it's an example of paradigm that we've done on Arcolentos, for example. And since this is very well received, you know, this in the offshore business, it's young, so people are open to accept new things.
Yeah.
So to go that way and use eventually the OU part might help us to break the guideline.
Yes, thank you. I received this and you sent to my colleague Mirek in Iran and sent it to me because we are working together. And it is indeed useful. We have also the step of some kind of a regular part, which is also what I'm trying to do then. So I think now, out of the discussion, the best way is to send out, I have to do 2-3 small corrections by Monday to some people this version. In the meantime, I can try to make these references to the case studies based on what is on the web page to find out.
Also, maybe we have to check for this that maybe strangers in the department maybe look the possible things. Because they are a complete collection of the content that is like. You just read what you do is about the study, you have to play.
I know, it is Facebook. Okay. Can I, without being a member in Facebook? For each case now. Very good, yes, I would like to receive that.
If you mentioned the website a few times, we already have something for the case studies on the website, for standardization of the website, yes.
No standardization, nothing. No. Only my presentation. I don't see anything in your website, nothing about this. You have this about
it? Yeah, nothing.
There was somebody who was taking the whole time.
Yes.
There is not yet, yes. And he just wrote an email if he can find
it. If you can check for the social case studies, do you speak with their parents or somebody's father?
So let's come back to the website and global file. So, still we need to do some work, and when it's almost ready, then we can at least have the website described on the ideas of the summaries of the area as well.
I think for the presentation in Lisbon, which I think it is not good for the website. What my presentation in Lisbon, all got already.
I'm sure we have to. So I'm sure it's already there, but the point is, I'm referring to put it on our T142 webpage as it's a website for the local 5 as for any other local. And yes, I'm sure the material is already there, but we may request, we should request in the next month. Let's put something on the website. Okay.
But you mean that you want a page for the working group file?
For each of the working groups, the working group file. this is also the idea of why I asked for the fictions. So,
one second, these practices.
Yeah.
Are you going to put them? You have to finalize these practices, so we have to discuss how to finalize these practices. Which are presented today, more.
The fictions for this workshop should be end up in a workshop report. So we are putting them together. I would like to come back to the point of standardization organizations. I think we have been taking this before, but there's many more than JCSS. We are in contact. It's ISO, it's the offshore winds energy community. John is active. I think there's also some potential to enter these organizations. This is for me never as many organizations as it's not possible. And the last point I want to mention is the outreach consulting. How do we get that?
Outreach means you have to go one step further. And as I said, outreach can be, let's say, meetings with engineers to convince them to use. So it's the interaction with practicing engineers. The presentation in committees, so I don't have any specific traditional home, as the three I said, the implementation in the courses. This is outreach, long term. You have an idea?
I didn't get it. How do we enter consulting? How do we enter consulting? So that means we need to simulate the request of your information analysis, but so this would be that we would seek to get in touch with our authorities. And we also can think of in which areas we may start to establish expertise on the level of information analysis, which are again need to be requested from industry. How can we simulate this process? Then the first thought about this is to use the project versions. To use the project versions, we have been initiating a call here, and so we get in touch with someone who some industrial enterprise, and we try to show them what we can do for them.
Just a comment is back. This is a question. Not only approach to the authorities, but I think the most efficient approach to put this effectively implemented in the real economy. I think we need to work out some towers, regulation. I don't know if this is something that's like regulation. So in terms of trying to include this of the value of information analysis as an option in the codes, as a or pushing that. So the owners, they see okay, in practice, because of course we can sensibilize owners to this is better, even in this budget I was discussing this with Apple. So they need to see that it's better. But I'm sure that the most efficient way, this is not something that you do in a short period, it's a long run, is by putting this in the code, in
somehow that there is a section that tells you, of course, in this big data, we have more and more data in this channel. There is evidence of all these case studies, papers, whatever, all this knowledge that is continuously being acquired should be included in the codes, either the model code or the geo code, same section, let's say. If data is available, you have a technique which is valuable information that allows you to do certain things, which then it's up to a case by case decision. If the owners, the people that are responsible, see this in the codes, I'm sure it will be very difficult. This is a comment.
So we have one thing is the regulations which you mentioned, and we have another code 2020 and the euro code which are under development. In the model code 2020, we have already impact, and it is possible to include some, let's say, sentences or paragraphs. In the euro codes, it's a different philosophy, but I am in a group which is dealing with existing structures, so that is exactly what the project is, so it starts now to work, so it's also possible to discuss how to deal with that, because it's important to get data of an existing structure and verify it. So I agree with your comment, it should be good to have something inside. We have the pre-standardization documents, or the standards which we developed here, and then we have some services in the regulation. With respect to consulting services, this is on an individual basis. You can start mentioning this background, these documents, if you need, like you make things out, if somebody calls and needs a client, knows a service is this. Not only for himself or for his company, and then in general, yes, you mentioned this project, so I think. We have here people from the industry, well respected people, so also one can start. The problem is that one has to demonstrate that you save money out of it. This is very important.
Okay. What we are discussing, I understand now we are also discussing other outreach activities, the most common. Because, or just standardization. Because of course putting all this in the codes as a long term has a long term perspective, but maybe we can do something with a short time impact, because when the case studies will be ready, some of them at least, and when the guidelines will be ready, which will be by the end of the action, we can think to go and promote this, organizing, I don't know, at the local engineering group in each town, a day where we present this, this framework, our framework, but not of course in terms of people's theory, which is too difficult, but through our case studies. We present our case studies. The machine works like that. You can use it. Here are the guidelines. And this has a very short term impact. I mean, we can do it in May 2019 without waiting that the rules are ready. Of course,
I'm not saying 2 weeks. I'm just saying that we should pause.
I'm not saying nothing against you. I'm just saying that this is a long term perspective, but we can have also a short term perspective.
I agree.
Yes, but one has to see how it will be financed.
Is there something that is not the money we can use? We can get the performance here. And maybe you should have support.
Already, if you are in the actual conference, there are many people from the industry and from authorities there. So the next years, your idea was good to present in Portugal. Unfortunately, I cannot come, but the idea was good.
But if you are
doing
the
coming up,
there are
no costs.
Some of
those
there,
like
the
engineers,
some
engineers in the lab. For example, may I say an example? The FIB has an FIB building on existing structures. This was
named by Raphael, Robbie, and Mir. They have a bulletin, 8. They are doing in Torino 5th and 6th February for the Italian engineers. They get exactly what you they get for free the bulletin, and they pay 300 euros and they get the conference. So this can be something which finances it, you know what I mean? So they get, you can arrange, you get the case studies and the results, but they are anyhow for free in our case. And you arrange with some more contribution, at least something like that. That is a possibility.
We actually have the designation event tool. This is basically what you're doing now. We have this tool and we have budget for this. So we need someone to organize. We as a group, some of us should organize. So
which we have budget for June next year to organize.
No.
That's a problem. And you have to, for example, myself, I cannot, but just to be honest, to the time limitation. So these activities which Helder was proposing by email have to be organized before.
Yes.
Okay.
Also some of my work presented in the Workgroup 5 session. I've been taking up the guideline on the quantification of structural health information. So we had here a rather late start and no progress. So now we have a little progress, and I would like to tell you of the little progress I've been studying. This is one of our key deliverables. It's the guideline for scientists, basically. Dimitris has previously spoken with the focus on the guideline for the practicing engineers. We have been, thanks to Dimitris and Jaroslav, been working quite substantially already on this. This now is the guideline for all the scientists. It's structures basically with the core parts. How do we quantify the value of structural health information? This is part 2, part 3. How do we model and utilize structural health information? And then how do we assess and rank the structural health information? This is part 4, followed by an example. We have been hearing at the very beginning of today something about domains of structural health monitoring, or we could term this as structural health information. We are more broad, not just to focus on monitoring. So this is a slight change in the terminology. And then we could classify the domains in anything which goes with the operation phase. This is part 1. The second part is code integration, basically. So here we are in the design phase, but with a large portfolio of structures, and we have the same objectives, and the objectives are the utility, the functionality, the integrity, risk management. We are dealing with infrastructure systems. So it's the operation phase, the design phase for code calibration, structure prototype development and testing, design by testing. It's also the design phase, it's zoomed in. And we should not forget the law committee is the SNH Shrine system development, structural health information system development. And here I will be happy about activities in this regard, especially with the structural health monitoring community. Qualification of the structural health information, this is what we have explored, especially in working group one, but for me also very important in working group four. Working group four presenting after working group five, after the coffee break, right? And how do we set up decision analysis and decision scenarios. It's one aspect. The other aspect is systems agility acceptance criteria modeling. So this goes to the boundaries of our value of information providers. And we link here the SSS document of risk assessment in engineering. As Mario Ferro pointed out, the guidelines are to serve also the context of the JCSS, so there is the link. It's not necessarily for this type of systems. The acceptance criteria is the JCSS document of risk assessment in engineering. It's not the policy protocols. The policy protocol is rather deeper than the individual components modeling of the system. Once we have set up the decision analysis and the decision scenario, or the other way around, the decision scenario and the analysis, we can then derive an objective function. So this provides the overview of structuring this section. This is a well-known visualization with the symmetry of a value of information analysis, prior analysis, pre-posterior analysis, consisting of information outcome actions, life cycle performance. When we think of activities associated, when we think of the life cycle performance, we think of the temporal dimension, so we have basically this is what we usually do when we consider the operation phase. We have a connection of several decision trees. So this is the thick dash lines from one time frame to another. And then we also have the dependencies of our points throughout the time. And this is the thin dash lines. So this is a temporal dimension, but not a life cycle dimension. Life cycle dimension is then here that we have decisions and information outcomes actually in the planning and design phase, in the manufacturing phase, in the construction, the operation and maintenance phase, which is the largest phase of the life cycle, and then the decommissioning phase. It's about the temporal dimension and the life cycle, and it's about the system modeling. So this is symbolized with system modeling visualization of the framework of Workgroup 1. So it's about the scenarios, the hazard constituent damage and failure states leading to system damage and failure states. This is usually the site from the structure engineer. We are designing against failures and damages. But we should not forget the functionality of the system. So intact, economically safe, and environmentally consistent. This is what we what we have and what is providing the benefits. We are not used to models, but we think of our own decisions, we decide on benefits, and of course, risk informed and most of the time, but decisions are our benefits. So, now coming to the methodological core, this is how we want to structure the health information and how we utilize it. So, the first point here is the structure of health information strategies. You had non-destructive testing, so that's campaign as measured information. You had proof volume, and I also have that here damage detection information and rather long infections. You also have destructive testing, right? But maybe it's as included in measurement. Information. Yeah. Can you just like if anything more to add? If anyone has an idea? Is there something missing? Structuring health information strategies. System update. SHI strategies. SHI strategies.
Thank you.
circuits, right? And then it's this is the headline, and then there's an description of how this strategy
works.
Yeah. Three reasons for damage detection, but you can just take the measurement information, for instance, for fatigue. You can just take the measurement information, and then we can enter already. Then we can go directly from measurement into the structural model, where we have damage detection information, basically have an indication or a normal indication. So here we have an event, the same as with the proof of it. And the inspections are that very local measurement.
Because you cannot classify it this way. I think it's very wrong. Because basically, when you do inspection, you do measurements. You cannot say how you justify it. You make local measurements, you make global measurements. This is not that. So you have inspections. During inspections, you take measurements. You can do visual inspection, you can do non-destructive testing. Then, you can, if you're not happy with this, you can do low testing. Loads, and that's not necessarily good for testing, you can do different flow testing. And then, based on it, you will do detection of damage. So, in the way you present it, it's not logical to my
thanks for the feedback. The difference between measurements and inspection is the temporary dimension, right? You don't measure, and then our test and damage detection, this is
looks like all this is inspection, because we already don't know what to do.
The first step is sort of
like inspection,
for bridges, the first step is division and inspection. You think there's an underlying logic or connection with you, but it's not on this side. It's rather in the way of how the information we classify so that we can model in conjunction with the structure. This is not visible here. Maybe this is way why it is very good this slide, it's a little hard to understand. Sending to the back.
Thank you. Classifying things in a messy, real complex world is of course difficult, and I can perhaps better demolish what is there. kind of comment here is, have we ever clearly defined what the purpose of structural health monitoring is? Because do we think that it's damage detection, or is it why? Because if I look at, let us think there are things there, like proof loading. Proof loading is not about the detection, right? It's about performance measurement, perhaps. Right? It's not that you're damaged by a proof loading as such, or this is not its main reason. Whereas here, in the context of SHM, it's damage detection, right? Again, SHM is in my view, which is broader than damage detection. It's about also measuring performance, perhaps the continuous way, and so on. So it all starts with kind of back to basics, right? What do we clearly, precisely understand as SHM? Right? Because we have the value of SHM, other things can come to the picture, like inspections and so on, because they are taken for the decisions of court.
Thank you for the interesting points, Ray. If we want to make it comprehensive here, then it's about structural health information. It's not about SHM. It's not about inspections. Let's try to make it comprehensive. And we have the idea is to summarize all structural health information, but of course mostly the ones we can clearly model, and what we can clearly model is what we see here. But I understand that this slide is not self-explaining. The document should be. My point of this slide would be, is there something which is not on the slide in terms of comprehensively addressing structure and health information or any information we can obtain from the structure? So this would be my question.
Right to move to the structure of information rather than also in the context of what you are trying to do, right? Being broader, then monitoring is just part of it. That said, monitoring, SHM, S in S, structure of health monitoring, completely disappeared from that slide now, right? And this is deliberate, or is it just accident? Or because yeah, it is an important concept. It is kind of replaced by measurement information and perhaps damage detection information. Yeah. I don't have thought, but the whole idea also of just saying structural health monitoring and it's sort of historicalism, right? But it's kind of still sometimes speaking in kind of wrong direction because it's not always health. There are aspects like performance as such, right? Is it health or health? So the definition of health is, right? For example,
thank you for the point. Monitoring from the slides, we may think of measurement and monitoring information. In that sense, so because the distinction between measurement and inspection is basically temporal, measurement and monitoring information would make more clear that it is a continuous measurement we are taking, that the inspections are temporal and discrete.
I think, depending on how one sees this, I think this is a very nice classification of what the board list. Okay? For example, you have separate measurement information with double detection information, although you use the measurement to do damage, but it has to be separated because in the measurement information, you'd like to know how to optimize whatever you're trying to measure, okay? Because you don't just place sensors, you might want to optimize where you place sensors, what kind of, even the proof loading, what kind of loading you're going to optimize your loading scenarios if you want. Just to collect the maximum information that later you do for damage detection and so on. So this is an idea, like separate the four things that you've done. So always depends how you look at that and what are the details hidden, because you don't have the details. But I can find out a lot of details in order.
Yeah, also, thank you for pointing that my damage detection information, of course, rely on some measurement and monitoring information. One point to this is that the measurement information can directly go into the structural model, whereas damage detection or measurement information used for damage detection do not go directly in this structural model. They go via the indication event on the structural model. Adam had
very briefly. I think I understood the comment of our last story. I think the way you presented it, from my experience, it tells you that something like your approach is proactive in terms that you are, when you say measurement information, can be about monitoring continuous on time. That information might be able to use some algorithm that can act like a detection. And if those algorithms decide that something is happening to your protocol, and then you do something more detailed, so you can inspect it. But I think you want to have this approach to optimize. I think it makes sense from the bottom to the top. The measured information should be like a model, could be simple, also running that is collecting information over time. And you have a progressive system approach. When you are trying to reverse the order of what is being done now, which is inspection, I want to optimize a little bit based on something as it's my basic line.
Use measurement information to optimize inspections and inspection value. But again, this is not intended here with this list.
Thank you.
Okay.
This was the SFI strategies, the classification. Thank you for the discussion and the inputs. It always points to the same point, needs to get better and ready. So that it's also better to understand it because there's more information. It goes on with the probabilistic characteristics of SHI, and this is linked to work group 2 and the uncertainty qualification request. I have so far put here a limited position due to the SHI measurement process. So the measurement uncertainty we heard already. The SHI system installation, where exactly are the zeroing placed? This can be a challenge. You are asking structural health control here, where is the sensor? And he does not exactly, and he knows where it is approximately. Okay, there's uncertainty about the SHI system installation, the operation of the system, and also human errors. So, and now, 3.3 and 3.4 is how we are modeling these SHI strategies. So, one way is to work with indication events and likelihood functions. So, if you have a likelihood function, then we can do the Bayesian update of distributions. And we introduce a threshold, then we can define an event and calculate the probability of an event. So, this is one way. And then in 3.4, how do we give a measurement information? This goes to the exploitation of the characteristics of model uncertainties. So yes, we create the instruction performance with a model which has limited precision. But when we measure, we may get to know, subjected to the SHI uncertainty, we may get to know the realization of the model uncertainty. So this is 3.4, and there may be also approaches in relation to working with quality information. It's inequality information which go to 3.3 and 3.4. Part 4. How do we assess the structural health information? And we assess it in a way that we provide the decision support for implementation of SHI or not. But this is the first decision model in our decision tree. We identify the optimal SHI strategy, the optimal actions, and the connection between both. This is decision rules. So we want outcome when I observe a certain outcome. Or a specific outcome, what will be the action? So that the system can be optimally run. So this is the decision rules, and then we can also talk about the significance and effectiveness of these decisions. So, this is the problem. Talking about part 2, part 3, part 4, not about part 5. Here we need to take up a principal example. It's mainly both out of the group 3 benchmark, or maybe something out of our papers. We have to see all. Or maybe simply a few examples together with both of the crew. Let's see what we can do, and I will come back to the one or the other of you to ask for contributions. But I would also say something about resilience and sustainability. And this is basically here what we mean. Can you just wait until I finish? So where is the sustainability and resilience? It's somehow linked in the framework, and the point is it's exactly in the objectives here. So it's the environmentally friendly system, so that's a sustainable system. So this is about sustainability, and when we quantify sustainability, we need to quantify the environmental impacts. And this can be done in the confidence domain. So in this way, this can be directly addressed as part of the consequences to the environment. And the resilience is something that's maybe this is a relative parameter on how fast the system can recover its functionality. There is a relation between resilience and value of information, but this is rather a topic of research.
I was wondering why you referred to the principal example, where you are saying maybe use the benchmark of the working group 3 and not one of the case studies. I mean, for example, the benchmark that they presented is to produce data, then what? To use this data to apply.
The principal example, you should not be the case. It should be somehow illustrated and a little more easy to explain than the case. But we have the other guideline for participating in for engineers, more focus on engineers. There, the case studies are one or two. This has been overtaken from the contents proposal of my favor, the principal example.
So we
no, we will do, but we don't know exactly what it is.
We are talking about principal example, as the main example, but principal example, as example of fundamentals.
Yes,
opposite. So it's principle. Example of illustrating principles, not principles.
Coffee break?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Bring us coffee.
say, how to